Good evening. From our headquarters in Kiev, this is the Sunday show on Hromadske International, the only primetime English-language TV show bringing the Eastern European geopolitical storm to you in English. My name is Josh Kavensky.
And I'm Tamara Rosevan. We've got an interesting program for you this weekend. We have a number of topics. E-declarations. This week, Ukrainian journalists have been dissecting the expensive assets and incomes of tens of thousands of Ukrainian top officials. Now, we'll also be discussing Ukraine's public television broadcaster under the spotlight after the head of the organization quit in an effort to bring attention that there's a lack of funds in next year's budget, and they're supposed to be covering the Eurovision Song Contest. Now, a bit later about the U.S. elections, which are happening on November 8th, and we have a very interesting interview with Timothy Snyder, history professor at Yale University and Ukrainian ambassador to the U.S., and we'll also be speaking or hearing an interview with a top justice ministry official who will be telling us about the ministry's plans on prisoners who are currently being held illegally in the Luhansk occupied territory in eastern Ukraine.
And I want to remind you that you can download our podcast on Mixcloud, and that's if you want an audio version, only version of this show. You can also see full versions of all of our interviews on YouTube. Those are uploaded after the show goes live. You can also, if you want to watch this in Ukrainian, there's currently a Ukrainian language broadcast being broadcast on YouTube right now.
And we'll be back in a few minutes.
November 1st was the deadline for the first wave of Ukrainian civil servants to declare their assets as part of an IMF-pushed reform that mandates that public officials declare in detail their property, their expensive items, and their financial holdings. Over 50,000 Ukrainian officials have declared these assets. The vast wealth of Ukrainian politicians, often from people who make hundreds of dollars a month, has caused a major outcry among civil society, and the public, it seems, has not been able to stop talking about it over the past month. In fact, President Petro Poroshenko filed his declaration very close to the deadline, revealing that he had over $26 million kept in bank accounts, and as well as holding ownership in 104 separate offshores and charity funds.
Prime Minister Volodymyr Groysman wrote a letter recently where he's praising the efforts made by the Ukrainian government to as part of the e-declaration reform program. And he's saying that it's another step against corruption. Why I declared my wealth and made Ukraine's elite follow suit is the headline on The Guardian of his op-ed. Now, in it, he is closely discussing the as my declaration has shown, I am not the poorest man in the country, though I am far from the richest. So a little bit of fascinating information there. Also this week, he said that about 50% of the country's economy is in the shadow today. This is, and he said that raising the salaries of the government of officials and judges and ministers will potentially get the economy out of the shadows.
And you know, it's really Ukrainian journalists have been particularly mesmerized by these declarations. We now have Ukrainska Pravda editor Siv Gil-Masaeva-Borovik joining us.
And good evening.
Thank you for coming to joining us today to discuss. So Siv Gil, thanks for joining us again. My first question is, I think a lot of people were surprised by how honest a lot of the officials were. People expected maybe people to fill it out in a way that wasn't necessarily disclosing as much wealth as they had, but for a lot of officials, it seemed that the admissions were essentially tantamount to admissions of some guilt. So why, in your opinion, were the officials so honest?
So honest?
Yeah.
Of course, I think that they're afraid, because a lot of anti-corruption bureaus, anti-corruption officials appeared after Revolution of Dignity in Ukraine. And I think that in this case, of course, our officials, our authorities did everything possible to destroy declaration, and I know how it was during last year. First of all, for members of parliament did it. Then in August, we had a situation where it's, we said that, okay, maybe it will be impossible to do it. But I think 1 month ago, everybody, all authorities understood that of course, e-declaration it will be so. That's why we need to declare more and more, because we don't need we don't know how it how it will be for us for example for the next year. That's why in those declaration in this year all officials showed everything possible.
Very very good point, but. It seems that a lot of Western analysts have been puzzled over this. What's the whole point of it? No official has yet resigned. No politician, despite these vast sums of cash that they seem to hold. Nobody has resigned. Should these politicians have to prove that they obtained their wealth legally? Do you think this should be part of the e-declaration system?
It's work for anti-corruption bureau. It's work for our new agency against corruption. I mean NAZK and NABU. And I hope those agencies will do everything possible that there will be some investigations. And of course, for Ukrainians, it's also very important now to have results for after e-declaration. Because if we will have no results after this shock for all Ukrainians. Because I know that all Ukrainians, me too, investigator reporters during last maybe 5 years, and also was shocked for such watches, churches, and of course a lot of cash for Ukrainian politicians, and that's why we need to have a result of this investigation, and I hope that we will.
But at the same time, I mean, it's been 2.5 years since Maidan. The government hasn't put a single corrupt official in jail. Mm-hmm. I mean, how confident are you that the government will actually use this as an opportunity to really prosecute people and go after this?
And I think it's answer all because why they're afraid, because they have now we have independent agencies, independent NABU, independent agency against corruption, I mean NAZK. And for a lot of officials and for members of parliament, they have no idea how it will do for them, because we have such cases, for example, against also Alexander Onishchenko, NABU case, and Alexander Onishchenko last year, we know that he was very close to our officials, first of all, for presidential administrations. And for a lot of members of parliament, they understood that there will be some investigations, and that's why I hope so.
I see, but now you've just said one of the investigative agencies. Another one, Ukraine's National Agency for Corruption Prevention, mm-hmm. as I understand, they were designated to mm-hmm. Investigate some, you know, corruption mm-hmm. within the system. The head, as I understand, Natalia Korchak, mm-hmm. has been accused of kind of mishandling this the budget that she had for her agency. Mm-hmm. She essentially gave herself bonuses mm-hmm. over the whole year mm-hmm. and her own people. Mm-hmm. She gave numerous bonuses, in fact. And how does this look?
Investigations by Radio
by Radio Liberty, yes.
Yeah, I was also shocked by this investigation. And I think in a normal country, it will be investigation against head of this anti-corruption bureau, I mean, NAZK. But in our country, a lot of things works like this case. Because Korchak described that they have no change to pay it for money for a lot of members of this NAZK. And she said that work for NAZK will be destroy if they will not pay for money bonuses because they used this money, you know, like a salary for other members of Nadeka. But of course, it's not a good idea because Nabu and Nadeka now they have a chance to change things in our country. And it's very important for those agencies to keep transparency. And of course, such cases how you described this situation with Natalia Korchak, of course, it's not good for their future work, first of all.
But one common feature we saw with almost every deputy, almost every official, was that they had hundreds of thousands of dollars in cash. It wasn't in bank accounts. It was just hryvnia or dollars, just literally under the like under the mattress, or just cash amounts of the money. So, I mean, why is that? What's the benefit of just keeping the money, you know, in the physical form?
Oh, of course, you described that it was because of our economy is in shadow, and I understood also the words of our prime minister. He said that there are no chance for our bank system, and our bank system was destroyed after previous regime and after revolution in dignity. You know that there are a lot of banks closed, and of course it's one reason, and the second reason that of course it's, there are a lot of corrupted money, and also you know last scandal in this year was with black accountancy of Party of Regions. It also was a cash story. And a lot of, I understood that in our politics there are a lot of cash, and for example, four votes in parliament for an important laws. I mean, when there are no enough voices for some laws. That's why, of course, I understand why there are a lot of cash. And of course, we have also version that it will be cash for future, because if, for example, in next year some of officials will declare, for example, more cash because they like corrupted guys. So of course there will be a lot of cash, and that's why maybe it's also changed for some corrupted guys. They declare, for example, $1.5 million, and they and after a year when they have declared such money, or they will for example, buy houses or another stuff, watches. They can describe it. Of course, I got this money last year. Of course,
yes. And these dubious purchases make a lot of people wonder. Really, for example, Petro Poroshenko. Mm-hmm. He declared over 100 companies, mm-hmm. and he said that he's received income from that, but. He didn't specify exactly how much money that has brought him. He just declared these companies. So do you think that some changes should be made to the e-declaration system itself so that, you know, the public has answers to these kinds of questions?
Of course, and for presidential declarations, I also have questions because he, for example, declared some pieces of arts, only not describing what pieces of arts he has. Just said that there are 17 items of these arts, but of course, a lot of depends from what is the name of this work, what is the author of this work, and society and Ukrainians have questions. And in the same way, of course, for such a situation with companies, because, for example, Vitaly Khmetynik declared his
a range of interesting
yes.
attributes.
Yeah.
I
yeah,
assume.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he declared it in a lot of companies. And he declares. He said that I just this is the name of company, and we don't know what is the assets of this company, because in this company we can have, for example, villas in Europe. and how it was with Mr. Lovechkin, because he declared one of company, and this is company ownership of his main asset is a villa in Kafra, south of France, and we investigated this company last year.
And that was something Leshenko, I think Leshenko was partly responsible for that investigation, but that also reveals another interesting point in this, is that a lot of the, it seemed that they were only the politicians were only declaring things that had already been revealed. They weren't really necessarily declaring offshores or properties that people didn't already know about. Mm-hmm. It was already things that were public.
And it's very important key for investigations, for journalist investigation, because, for example, in such a way, we also took information from different partnership in different companies. Interesting story with Sergei Lovechkin is also because Yulia Lovechkin, his sister, declared a lot of companies, which before journalists connected with Sergei Lovechkin, but now we understood that a lot of assets owned by his sister Yulia Lovechkina, and of course it's a conflict of interest for her.
So through second, third parties.
Yeah, that's correct. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining us, Sivgil. We appreciate it, and we will be back in 1 second with our next segment. The Ukraine National Television Director General Zora Balasania resigned this week in an unprecedented move calculated to draw attention to the sorry state of Ukrainian public media.
And specifically, Alasania alleged that the government had placed pressure on his channel for running investigative reports into corruption and complained that the government was financing next year's Eurovision by cutting into his channel's budget. You can watch the story here.
If my resignation will attract attention to public broadcasting in Ukraine, then that is my main goal. It is time to leave in order to say that it's not about a person, it's not about me, it's all about the institution. That's why people, please do something to make it a system, and also the politicians.
Okay, institution, but that's so general. Somebody has to change it.
Personal actions have been taken. Now my colleagues are doing that. It means a statute should be signed. It also means just a bill, according to which they have to provide financing to a public broadcaster. Any other way, there will be no public broadcasting. They must follow the rules they've created. I can see that these rules are broken, and I want to attract attention to that.
On what level do you see the strongest blocking of the reform?
There is no blocking. There are some technological things. The Eurovision budget is included in the budget of National Public Television and the Radio Broadcasting Company. They should have given us 800 million according to the law and an estimated 450 million for Eurovision. What they are doing is cheating us, and that is a disgrace. You can't say you have enemies of reform, but for real, the reform is over in such a case.
Now we have Ihor Rozkladai, an attorney at the Media Law Institute, joining us in our studio to discuss. Thank you for joining us, Ihor.
Hello.
My first question is, what are the immediate consequences of Alasania's resignation?
It's a very long story. It's a story for 26 years, maybe, because creating PSB in Ukraine, it's several attempts, and from different people, different point of view, how to create, with whom to create, on which base to create. And now we are on the point when we are ready to create. Really ready, because we have at least media environment, we have NGO, we have a lot of people who understand the importance of public TV. But we still have Soviet bureaucracy with all these instructions, all this understanding that we need to not to go in through the requirement by the law, but through the instructions or some points of instructions. And if something wrong, if something not in line with these instructions, staff or public authorities freezes. They don't know what to do, and they're waiting from some very huge support to act in a normal way. And last 2 years, it was a fighting with all this huge old bureaucracy, with all these problems we have maybe since 1950s, because a lot of documents about a lot of equipment and so on and so on, we have it from Soviet time, and that's why it's very difficult to do something quickly with this huge, very difficult machine. That's why I understand that the Rabolosani and his colleagues, they're really tired, because we plan to finalize reform in March 2016, and still we have problems. We still waiting and trying to predict whether we will have statute on December or not, whether a state the Treasury will act normally with all agreements and so on and so on. And again, another problem is Eurovision. Eurovision is very interesting case, because from one point it's power in reform, support reform, but from another side it's slow down reform.
Yeah, but it's right. it's a great opportunity for Ukraine to show some of its cultural sides and to show that it can, you know,
of course, but
this.
But to talk in more bureaucratic language, to sign any documents, it's quite high risk, because if you have no special regulation for Eurovision, you need to act in this huge massive of documents which sometimes are conflict between each other. And I understand that this example that Zurab told about crime case starting 2005 after those Eurovision, mm-hmm. and still present, it's a great picture to show that what we want. We want to create PSB, or we want to have a okay, excellent show, but later we will put in jail all people who are protagonists in this reform, who right. push this reform.
Right, but just to interrupt you there, you know, to play devil's advocate, mm-hmm. we can see how Western public broadcasters look, and we can see their figures. You know, we have the BBC for example, and Deutsche Welle, but TV broadcasting watchdog says that First National channel, Ukraine's, has just about 1% of total viewership.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's very low ratings, obviously.
Let's see, how effective could it really be with that level of
news? Quite high. Yeah. News under the August I saw August data, it was near 4%. But you need to understand first, in this country, you don't need to cover all population. You don't need to have huge rate. It's more important to work on those people who are active, who can, want, and who do changes here in this country. And for PSB now, it's the first audience. Of course, they need to cover minorities, elder people, younger people, and so on, with different cultural, educative, and other product.
But look,
in this moment, we still have state, not even organization by legal status, it's more like some administration. They're very limited by their acts. They're so limited that I understand that even to create what they create last 2 years, it's in some way impossible.
But at the same time, to develop a real democratic society, you can't just reach 1%. I mean, you have to reach beyond activists. You have to reach the large.
Of course.
Kind of people.
For me, this reform, I plan to say maybe whether it will be good or not in 2012, because I understand that to merge near 30 organizations, to change people, to change product, to change broadcasting, because they're still analog and digital, and I think that next year when we will switch off analog, and also helps to develop.
But right,
we need to do so much.
Yes, a lot of work. I agree. It's a massive organization.
From zero, maybe even from minus.
Right. Right. It's a massive organization. You have hundreds of employees.
Seven thousand plus.
That's a lot of people for any TV channel, I think. But how can public broadcaster, you know, justify getting more money if their results are so slow in terms of reform progress?
Let's say they do not ask more money. They ask those money prescribed by law, because if you want changes, you need to pay. It's not only about TV, it's about roads, it's about any changes in country. If you want to change something, you need to pay. To pay or by money or by your... you act and you do something maybe for free, but it's some equivalent for money. And while we have 7,000 people, we can dismiss them because we still have very old trade code.
Right, but how many people are you willing to dismiss? Do you think all of these 7,000 employees are essentially effective?
I think that some amount of people could be good for PSB, but let's compare with Telewizja Polska in Poland. 2,000 and 1,200 people for all Poland, for TV1, TV2, TV History, TVP Regionalne, to Belsat, and so on. 2012. Okay, Ukraine larger country, maybe 3.5, but not 7,000. It's really, if you saw this infographics prepared by our colleagues from Detector Media, only 3% of their total costs go into product. It's a normal situation. You pay for rent, you pay for broadcasting, you pay for salary, and you have no to change your content. And PSB now, this 2 years trying to find some outsources, uniting with you, with Gromadsky, with other investigative products, always support some people. But sorry, it's not sustainable, it's not systematic job. They need to change their system. But to change their system, they need to change their legal entity. And unfortunately, we lost 1 year because of Ukrtelefilm, this film studio with a very small amount of people, but they block reform up to changing the law.
Right. So you've obviously had some roadblocks in that sense, but it seems that, you know, the work that you can do is still there and it's still possible. So thank you so much for joining us here today.
Mm-hmm. And we can now show you a clip from our Reforma team, which went deep into the reforms at UA Perche, and we can show that to you right now.
This is how Ukrainian TV broadcasting began. Broadcast by a Kiev studio in 1951. It soon became Republican TV, and then turned into UT1. Now, it's UA Perche, which will become a public broadcaster very soon. The reform has been ongoing for 2 years already.
Hello.
Hello. Let's go.
Why have you chosen UA Perche? Because here we have the luxury of talking about everything and everyone we want. It seems to me that in our conditions, it's a luxury for beginning journalists. That's why I've chosen it.
Because of the freedom?
Absolutely. When I tell my friends that for 2 years of working here, I've never heard whom we have to film and whom not to, they think I'm not being sincere, but it's true.
I came here in late 1997. The 7 Days TV show was produced at that time. It's absolutely clear who was producing it and who it was being produced for. It was the key political show which secured victory in the presidential elections in 1999. There is no doubt that it was an instrument for achieving concrete political objectives, no doubt. There were no hints of impartiality and objectivity in the show. My footage wasn't censored, but I clearly understood what I couldn't do. It's true.
The law on the system of public television and radio broadcasting of Ukraine was adopted in April 2014. According to it, 28 regional state broadcasters, the National TV and Radio Broadcasting Company Culture TV channel, will create the National Public Broadcasting Company of Ukraine, 100% shares of which will belong to the state. Regional broadcasters have to go through a special procedure of transformation from independent bodies to subsidiaries of the National Public Broadcasting Company, the National Radio Company of Ukraine, Culture TV Channel, and Ukrtelefilm have to become central directorates of the National Public Broadcasting Company of Ukraine. After such reorganization, the National Public Broadcasting Company will be registered as a public company. Then it will renew licenses for regional broadcasters after a competition and receive their property for use.
Here we were holding both the national presidential and parliamentary debates. As you can see, the Battle of the Cities for hosting Eurovision is the latest one that we've held here. We can't rent a studio without the assistance of donors and grants. That's what we have. You can see how it looks. Of course, we don't need it much. The majority of our cameras look like that. It's possible to work with such equipment, but...
And what if you receive a job offer from another TV channel which belongs either to an industrial group or to an oligarch that offers a higher salary?
There were such proposals, but I don't want this. I like having freedom in my actions. When I'm sure that tomorrow I'll come to the Verkhovna Rada and prepare the report that I want without listening to what I have to do and what not, what it's better to show and what not. It seems to me that freedom of actions is one of the key things for journalists. It's very hard to be a journalist and know that there are things you can't talk about. It creates boundaries.
Речі, про які тобі не можна говорити, це якось тебе дуже сильно обмежує.
The TV market in Ukraine is rather saturated, and according to social surveys, people watch TV quite a lot. So why are the National TV and Radio Broadcasting Company and public broadcasting so important in this case?
It's important to make it an alternative to the toxic TV market, which consists of commercial media. Each TV channel has its owner, as far as you know. They work in the interests of their owners, and people don't even notice it. They are poisoning people's brains, and they don't even notice it. We have to make this channel independent from oligarchs, money, because the time for commercials is being reduced, and from the state. But there's also a flip side. They do not help us. You understand? When in this country, friends can do anything they want, and enemies have to abide the laws, we suffer. That's why we've been left alone. By the way, people don't have a positive attitude towards us because of the awful and long-term UT1 background. Despite the fact that 2 years have passed, the picture on the TV screen hasn't really changed. People got used to the fact that we removed all the bad things very quickly, but the rest, they require quality, which we can't give them because we don't have the money for it. But everything will be fine.
Але буде. Все буде. Та.
Суспільна реформа важлива тут.
Public broadcasting reform is important because we will objectively, in the case that it's successful, of course, without having any owners, bosses, or oligarchs convey information to the people. Objective information and a neutral point of view is very important for Ukraine in order to have an independent media and a TV broadcaster that could make it possible.
Бачення, яке б дійсно могло собі це дозволити.
The National TV Company of Ukraine has little money at its disposal. The funding is limited and there is no support of donors for TV production. But we see some progress in the reform. The most important is that, although the picture of the news is worse than on commercial TV channels, there is less news, fewer journalists, the quality is worse.
America goes to the polls on Tuesday in an election that will pit businessman and reality TV star Donald Trump against former Secretary of State and noted email aficionado Hillary Clinton. The race has been one of the dirtiest in the history of the United States. But we right now have Natalia Humanyuk, our very own journalist and correspondent here, joining us live via Skype from Cleveland. Hi, Natalia, how are you?
Hi, good. We're here where just now that would be in a convention center. As you might see, that would be a last Hillary's rally in Ohio, which is an incredibly important state, as a lot of people understand. I'm just here where the people just getting. I'm waiting for my turn to talk to you. So she would be talking with the famous basketball star LeBron, and Ohio is really, really very important, as a lot of you see the people there, as a lot of other states, because the race is very, very close. I've traveled around the country from North Carolina, South Carolina, to Georgia. We do have you.
Yeah, and you know, one thing we've seen is that the polls are tightening between the two. So, I mean, what's the atmosphere like at this Hillary rally?
Okay.
Hi.
Okay, we do have the people here. I'm working now.
Are you working?
Okay, yeah. So I'll let I would really, so you see a lot of people here.
Yeah.
It's very interesting because I've just come from Ohio, from a small county, which is extremely important, where I've had a chance to watch Donald Trump as well. And to talk more to the people, it's, you know, a lot would say it's about the economic troubles. But I would say that it's so much about the nostalgia for the past, which is not there. So I talked to some experts and people who are very much into the Eastern Europe. And they said that people just in the U.S. probably don't understand that things could get worse. And there is no this, you know, like if you speak to the Democrats, especially, like, do you think that what would happen if Trump wins? They say, like, we don't know. We never thought about that. So there is anxiety. There is a lot of anxiety, but there is no really plan for that. And the more you talk to the people on the small villages, the more you see that there are really a lot of Trump supporters, especially if you get out of New York, get out of Washington, and go to the smaller towns. Of course, not like here in Cleveland. It's a big town in Ohio, but travel around, you will see a lot of Trump signs. And really talking to the people, it's not just like poor people. You would have a lot kind of them. So it's really, anxiety is really there, and it's indeed very close.
Thank you for joining us, Natalia. We appreciate that.
Okay. Good luck.
And so we've heard a lot about how this is a very historic race. We have on one side Hillary Clinton, the Democratic presidential candidate, and she is the first female presidential candidate. You right. have, you know, women in middle America who say that they've waited 80, 90 years, their whole lifetime to vote for a woman president, for a woman president to take office.
It's ironic that you're being pitted against possibly the most openly misogynistic candidate who's like been out there since women were given the right to vote.
Exactly.
Yeah.
He said his history of unsettling behavior towards women is astounding. Let me read you some of the comments he said over the years. He said that sexual assault in the military is totally expected. That bad press doesn't matter as long as you have a sexy girlfriend, and that women must be hot in order to be a journalist. So a little bit of a tidbit of information there. But at the same time, Trump is also touted to be as this huckster, the booster, the snake oil salesman, mm-hmm. so to say. He appeals to a certain type of voter, a voter who is discontent, who believes that his taxes are basically paying
right.
for illegal migrants.
And I mean, and the interesting thing with that is, this, especially the snake oil salesman comparison, really connects back to Ukraine, where you had some of the same people who were working on the Trump campaign in its initial stages, also working on the Yanukovych campaign, the Party of Regions in 2010.
Paul Manafort.
Yeah, and you see, also if you look at profiles of the communities, it's very similar. You have these communities in the States that used to have big industry, and all the industries left. And you have these communities in Ukraine and Russia, and I guess Russia as well, that had all these big Soviet industries, and it just disappeared. And all of a sudden, it's like they almost want the same kinds of like strongmen to come in and save the day.
Yeah.
I think when you talk about the similarities between Ukrainian politics and U.S. politics, where exactly they overlap, you instantly think of Paul Manafort. You can't ignore the fact that this man who was leading, you know, Trump's campaign, and he had ledgers pledging millions of dollars to him through Yanukovych's
right.
You know, inner circle.
And actually, Seth Gill mentioned that earlier, the black accounting. And it's very weird to have somebody basically expensing a bribe, which is, it seems to be what he was doing on that. But you can also hear other analysis on this. Natalia Humanyuk, who we just spoke with while she was on her America tour, spoke with Tim Snyder. He's a historian at Yale University about the elections. You can watch that interview right here.
I have a friend who jokes that everyone in the world should be allowed to vote in American elections because American elections matter for everyone in the world. But in the United States, foreign policy is almost totally irrelevant, which means that if you read Russian newspapers or even Ukrainian newspapers about the American elections, you can get a very misleading picture. The American elections are chiefly about character and trust. To some extent, they're about issues like ethnic and racial and gender identity. To a very small extent, they're about policy. But foreign policy comes into it only a little bit at the margin. And the only reason it comes in is that it comes knocking on the door. If it weren't for the fact that Russia is so interested in being a part of the U.S. elections, Russia wouldn't be present at all either. As things stand, the only major issue in foreign policy which appears is the question of how to treat Russia. But that has to do with Russian foreign policy. It doesn't really have to do with the interests of the American people. Americans are not really thinking about foreign policy right now. The very few of the elites of the Republican Party actually support the Republican candidate for president. So that's unusual. We may be seeing the beginning of the end of the two-party system. A second thing which is unusual about this election is the strength of the cultural politics. The fact that the last president was an African-American and the next president is very likely to be a woman is something which many Americans, not most, but many Americans find difficult to take. And so for people who have those kinds of racial or gender prejudices, this election is really about identity in a very, very basic way. And Donald Trump plays to that very aggressively. We have never had a public figure, much less a candidate for president, who has so aggressively, at least in recent times, so aggressively played on both racial and gender politics. And the third thing which is new and interesting, but which is not particular to America, it's common across the West, from us through Europe, through Ukraine to Russia, is factuality and non-factuality. So, I mean, rather than right and left, I think the main distinction between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump is that Hillary Clinton basically resides in a boring world where facts are facts and truth are truth, and Donald Trump, a bit more like, let's say, a Russian politician, resides in a world where information is irrelevant, and all that matters is posture and spectacle and striking a pose. That's always true to some extent in politics, but we've never had it in the United States to this extent. If you think of Ukraine, I would say that identity politics of the sort of, you know, having to do with language or having to do with culture are less and less important in Ukraine. They're also less and less important in the United States. And 4 years from now, 8 years from now, I think these issues of gender and these issues of race are going to more or less have disappeared, just like issues of sexual orientation have more or less disappeared from politics. So I think this is historical in that this is the, you can see in Donald Trump, the last attempt to use questions of identity as questions of politics. Now, if Trump wins, these will be historical elections in a different way, because if Trump wins, we will then see, I'm not sure exactly what, but we will see dramatic consequences, not just in policy terms, but I think the United States will likely cease to be and to seem to be a state which respects the rule of law. So if Trump actually wins, then these will be historic elections in a very different way. Almost no one is expecting that at this point, but it's still possible. This sort of historical populism where, you know, the Russian leadership talks about a Russian past which has no connection to reality at all, and is sort of pure poetry, or where, you know, people who are in favor of Brexit talk about an English past which also doesn't really exist. England doesn't really have a past. Britain has a past. The British Empire has a past. But to look for an English past, you have to go back 1,000 years. Or French populist Nouveau National imagining that the interwar French state was something good and desirable, when in fact it was in most ways a disaster, at least compared to France of today. We have that too. Donald Trump's main slogan is "Make America Great Again," but no one really has any idea what that "again" was. And in many respects, the United States of 2016 is a better country than pretty much any other version of the United States. Now, all of that said, it leads to a different issue, which is probably more important. One of the reasons why nostalgia matters, which doesn't have to do with identity, is economics. One way that the United States is becoming a worse country from the perspective of many of its citizens is in terms of inequality. And so many of the Trump supporters, they look at their children and they say, my children will never do as well as I did. And they're right. Right, so they're looking at an objective phenomenon, which is the difficulty of moving upward in society. Again, something which is, Ukrainians know all about. They're looking at that, and they're drawing cultural conclusions, which I think are the wrong conclusions. They're saying, okay, this is because the world is against us, or the women are against us, or the minorities are against us, or whatever. But there's a real problem. The problem of inequality is a real one. And as the United States becomes a society with greater and greater wealth inequality, candidates like Trump, populists who can say, like, I know about the world because I have lots of money, you know, that kind of populism will probably have a future. Yeah, no, something really interesting and in some ways terrifying has happened in the last 4 or 5 years, and that is that in many ways, the history has tilted where, I mean, for a time, it was true that countries in Eastern Europe were trying to become more like countries in Western Europe, or trying to become more like countries in the West, and succeeding in doing so in various ways. I think that period is now over, and what we're seeing instead is that history is now tilting a different direction, and many things which happened first in Russia or happened first in Ukraine then happen later in the United States, right? So I find it very interesting that the people who A, understood Trump, and B, said he was a real danger in the United States, were very often people whose main job was to write about Russia or to write about Ukraine. It was very often people who were mainly looking at Russia or Ukraine or Eastern Europe who recognized this type of politics and said, no, this is real and this is dangerous. Most Americans didn't recognize it and also thought this can never really happen here, whereas, of course, it has happened here. So, I mean, my own perspective is that our problems overlap with Russian problems, overlap with Ukrainian problems, and sometimes one can learn from Russians and Ukrainians to figure out what's going to come next. It's very telling, for example, that, you know, the key document in this whole election, one of the documents that got Trump's main advisor fired was something which was found by Serhiy Leshchenko, right? This is no coincidence. There are these meaningful connections between the way politics are done here and the way politics are done in Kyiv and in Moscow. Deporting undocumented workers. He's used undocumented workers. He's made his product. the main way that, the Trump candidacy is like a Russian political campaign is this total indifference to the facts of the matter, like complete indifference to statistics, to experts, just to whatever might actually really be happening in the world, and a total reliance on gestures, spectacles, cliches, insults, references to violence, and references to sex.
Now, where does Ukraine fit in all of this? Ukraine is about to lose one of its biggest supporters in the White House, U.S. Vice President Joe Biden. Now, when Joe Biden came to Kiev, it was dubbed as Biden mania. Over the past, he's supported Ukraine through thick and thin, and when needed, he administered a tough love attitude. And he's largely seen by Ukrainian politicians as somebody who can potentially resolve their internal fightings, and as somebody who is a very big figure in the White House.
He's also very controversially, and the New York Times reported this in quite in a very interesting article last year. He very controversially, I think, has adopted some other elements of Ukrainian politics. As this article you can see from on the screen, his son joined the board of Burisma Holdings, a company that has a large stake in one of Ukraine's largest, I think, gas companies, which has been very controversial. And some allege that it's quite a conflict of interest, and that it also just more generally fits in with this style of Ukrainian politicians, allowing people they like to, at least the families and the families of those they like, to basically enrich themselves.
Yes, controversial in its own way, but there's no way denying it. Biden's role in the Ukrainian government has been huge.
Yeah.
There's going to be big shoes to fill, obviously. Who will fill them? That's the main question. I mean, it's been said that Biden speaks to Ukrainian leaders over the phone, you know, several times a month, and he's very hands on.
Hromadsky International, we through our, you know, our vestige in the United States, Natalia, she got to speak with Ukraine's ambassador to the United States, Valery Chali, in Washington. And in that interview, they spoke about the future of Ukrainian-U.S. relations and what it might look like after the departure of Uncle Joe Biden.
So the question would be that, of course, when there is a campaign, somehow the part of the political life is put on freeze. And what still Ukraine, you know, Ukraine and with all these issues we have, they are still there. So what Ukraine can feasibly expect from the U.S. at this stage, before 20th of January, in fact, and what are the key issues for the country like ours and our region?
Well, first of all, I would like to mention that, the important position of the leadership in the United States, including President of the United States, because despite of the having the great support, bipartisan support in the Parliament, in the Congress, we count on the firm position of the next President of the United States. Very important issue for Ukraine. First of all, it's a three priority. The first is support Ukraine in the situation, unless we are still in against aggression of Russian Federation. We need that support, bipartisan support, including Stand for Ukraine Act, is now considered in the Senate. The next is budget 2017. We count and we believe this will be a decision in the Congress and signed by President, receive not less money in this with support of Ukraine, not less this year. And also we count on the keep transatlantic unity and solidarity in Ukraine in sanctions policy. We understand that Russia not implement its own responsibility for Minsk arrangements. That's why the considering of the continuous rollover of the sanctions measures and the important issue. And finally, we want not lose a time in this transformation period. So we believe that the next 4 months after the election day and before the inauguration will be not less active for the acting administration and next administration, in the issue of Ukraine and our bilateral cooperation. So we understand priority, we understand how to achieve that, and I'm sure that this period of election, the schedule, not make a great impact of our bilateral relationship. And in future, we will work with any president who will come in office. It's a decision by American people. But what's most important for us is United States leadership. There's stronger bilateral relations because Ukraine contributes a lot in security, not only in Ukraine, but in Europe and in the United States. I'm as ambassador every time repeat that taxpayers of the United States now pay not a big amount of money for the stopping aggression, because we are Ukrainians and Ukraine paid unpredictable price for that, and 10,000 people killed. So I believe this American society, American president, consider that and contribute a lot in security in Europe through support of Ukraine in the future.
A few weeks ago, we spoke about Ukrainian prisoners in the occupied Luhansk region being exploited for cheap labor. We also spoke with a human rights activist who published a report detailing the unpaid, often back-breaking manual labor that hundreds of Ukrainian prisoners are physically forced in slave-like conditions to carry out. The products they produce are often sold for profit by the Russian-backed separatist forces, and not only in the occupied regions.
Now, we've also spoken to one of the relatives of a prisoner who's currently being held in the occupied Luhansk region. He was supposed to be freed along with hundreds of other prisoners as per President Poroshenko's amnesty, which was issued nearly 2 years ago. Now, currently no prisoners are being released from detention centers by the Russian-backed separatist forces from detention centers in the Luhansk region. Now, we've spoken to Serhii Petuhov, Ukraine's Justice Minister for Deputy Justice Minister for European Integration, to find out what the Ukrainian government is basically doing to secure the release of prisoners who were granted amnesty in 2014 but are still not being released. Take a look.
The penitentiary service has moved to Prizoro system of public procurement. So they're now part of this electronic system of transparent procurement. So, I mean, all the accusations of the possible corruption, and I agree that there was a lot in this system because it was very close, no one ever looked into that, are now having much less grounds because all the procurement happens publicly. Should there be any facts that would prove the allegation that some of the ex-members of this system make, I'm sure that they would be of high interest of our prosecutor's office, and we would be happy to cooperate with them on investigating any allegations of corruption and bringing those guilty of it to justice.
I see. But do you currently, do you know of any type of corruption going on within the prison service itself? Because as I understand, Mr. Starenki said that a lot of the documents are currently being destroyed, he said, because the penitentiary service is being dismantled. So he says that there will essentially be no proof of all these goings on.
Now, I wouldn't comment on something that has no factual background to that. I mean, the dismantling of the system is not done in any chaotic way. It's a process that has been underway for quite a while. There are normal public service reform that goes on. Nothing is being destroyed. If something is being destroyed, then those people who are responsible for keeping these documents will be prosecuted because, you know, there's a responsibility for keeping records of what you do.
Let's move on to a recent report. It's a Russian language report about prisoners in the occupied Luhansk territory, which are currently being used as slave labor by the Russian-backed separatist forces. Now, as I understand, the Justice Ministry hasn't really been doing anything in regards to those prisoners. Is the ministry planning to do anything now?
Because of the illegal nature of this kind of self-proclaimed regimes, there's no official or unofficial communication between us and them. So all the cooperation in matter of prisoners is done through Ukrainian ombudsperson, who directly has a direct counterpart there, and for humanitarian reasons, she of course cooperates with whoever who controls the Ukrainian nationals. And I think, you know, that channel has been successful because there has
been
already...
But that channel has only been successful in the Donetsk region, not in the Luhansk.
Now, of course, the success of this channel depends on the willingness to cooperate from the other side. If they're not willing, we are currently not able to force them to do that.
What does the Justice Ministry plan to do about cases like these of prisoners who were supposed to be amnestied and freed, mm-hmm. and there are hundreds of cases... but are still being kept in the occupied regions.
We are lucky to get the information about the situation in the region because Ukraine invited the United Nations monitoring mission, human rights monitoring mission, to be present on all of its territory and monitor the situation with the human rights. They have an access to the occupied territory, and they have an office in Donetsk. They have been reporting about the appalling conditions that the prisoners have to live in the occupied territory. As I said, the Ministry of Justice will have no role into releasing those people because they're illegally detained by illegal authorities. Therefore, we, in our position, we are bringing the attention of the international community and of Russia, who has a very direct involvement in what's happening there.
I see. Now, we've spoken to analysts and some human rights activists, and they said that these prisoners, they will possibly take the government to court. The Ukrainian government might have to pay mm-hmm. for compensation mm-hmm. to these prisoners. Mm-hmm. Now, what do you think about that?
Okay, the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg indeed has a practice of dealing with the occupied territories. They've been dealing with that in cases against Moldova and Transnistria, in cases of Nagorno-Karabakh, the disputed territory between Armenia and Azerbaijan, and for example, Northern Cyprus. So the legal standards in the cases of the of illegal occupation is that the state that retains the sovereignty has only the positive obligations of protecting human rights. So the state has to do all that is within its powers to make sure, as far as possible, that human rights are not violated. But the primary responsibility of protecting the human rights lies within the occupied power. So the European Court of Human Rights already recognized that the Russia is responsible for what happens in Transnistria by virtue of its overall control of all the situation. So we look at our situation as quite similar to that of Transnistria, meaning that Russia bears the primary responsibility for ensuring that the forces that are occupying our territory, that are controlled by Russia, are safeguarding and not violating the human rights. Whereas, of course, our positive obligation is to make all that is possible in our situation to free those people and to bring the attention of the international community to what's going on there.
You've been watching the Sunday Show on Hromadske International. I want to thank you for joining us. I want to remind you also that you can watch full versions of all of our interviews on YouTube. You can also go to our website, hromadske.ua, and click the International tab to see both articles and English language coverage, both in print and both in long-form articles, and also in a video forum of Ukraine. You can also go to the Kyiv Post, kyivpost.com, and read long-form journalism about Ukraine and Eastern Europe as well. I'm Josh Kavensky. Thank you for joining us.
And I'm Tamara Rosevan, and that's all we have for this week. Thanks for watching.